Greetings from the Philippines. I am David Ackerman, Field Education Coordinator for the Philippines Micronesia Field. I'd like to share three short stories of the effect of the alabaster offering upon the forming of ministry students in the Philippines and Asia Pacific. The first story comes from Messiah Nazarene Bible College, located in Cebu City. This college has about 60 students in its college ministry programs and over 300 in its kindergarten through 10th grades. The college is landlocked in a neighborhood with limited possibility for expansion. The college's old cafeteria was small, infested by termites, and not a good place to prepare or to eat food. The current president, Reverend Larney Sam Tabuena, had a vision to build a new cafeteria that would be a place of food, fellowship, and space for seminars and meetings. This past year, the college was granted alabaster funds to begin the new cafeteria. The funds were enough to start the first floor. A work and witness team came from Florida to help with the construction process. The goal is to finish the second floor and roof terrace in 2019. A second story comes from Asia Pacific Nazarene Theological Seminary, located on the edge of the capital city of Manila. APNTS is the graduate level seminary serving the whole Asia Pacific region and has about 250 students in all of its programs. The cafeteria is located along the stream that runs through the middle of the campus. Over the years, the large supporting wall began to give way, leaving big cracks in the floor of the cafeteria. Something major needed to be done before the whole building developed cracks or slide into the creek bed. Alabaster funds were a major resource to help save the cafeteria and remodel it into an attractive facility for the campus community. A second floor was added, which is used for study and a student center. The third story comes from Philippine Nazarene College, located in the mountains near Baguio. PNC has about 50 students in its ministry programs and has extension sites in several districts of the Philippines. It also has over 500 students in its kindergarten through senior high schools. The area around the college is very hilly. A developer from the property next to the college cut away the hillside by the administration building. Over the past year, with the heavy rains in the mountains, the 30-foot hillside began to give away, collapsing to within a few feet of the building. Everyone was concerned that the building would be damaged or worse, that it might collapse while students were in it. Alabaster came to the rescue with funds to build a large rock and concrete supporting wall. There were enough funds left over to fix the draining and roof problems for the administration building. Thankfully, the building is saved and ministry at the school can continue. Three brief examples of how alabaster funds given through local churches make a difference in critical areas on our field and where men and women are being prepared for leadership and service in the Church of the Nazarene in the Philippines and beyond. Thank you for your partnership with us in these ministries.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Faith Community Church of the Nazarene. I'm Pastor Derek. And that was a video about how alabaster funds have been helping churches and schools around the world. In case you're not familiar, alabaster, we're going to be taking an alabaster offering on the 24th of February. Alabaster funds are used exactly for that. They are funds that are pocket change that we collect a couple times a year that go specifically toward building buildings for churches and schools and hospitals and the like. In these instances, these schools are ministering and preparing future leaders in the church. They're preparing pastors and stuff like that. And now, because of alabaster funds, they can continue in that service. They can continue to prepare students to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so I would encourage you to be preparing for the end of this month. We will be putting the big box out here. We will be doing a march like we normally do to give money, to give funds to alabaster offering. I kind of jumped ahead in my talks. I want to welcome you this morning. I hope everyone got a bulletin. There's lots of great information in there. And inside of there, you're going to find one of these connection cards because we want to connect with you. This church thing, you know, many people get the idea that church is just a place that you go on Sunday morning, but church is a lot more than that. And so we want to help show you what the community of Christ is like. And if you're visiting with us this morning, I would encourage you to take some time and fill out this connection card. If you just want more information about the church, again, just fill out this connection card and drop it in the offering plate as it comes by. And part of that connection is prayer, because we want to be praying for you and with you. And so on the back side of that card is our prayer card, because we believe that Christ honors our prayers, that he answers our prayers, and we want to pray for you. So if you have a prayer request, if you have a praise, if you have something that you want prayer for, fill that out. There's a spot there for a confidential checkbox. If it's not something you want shared with the whole church, I understand that. And if you check that box, I will keep it to myself. And otherwise, I will broadcast it to everybody to pray for on Sunday mornings, to pray for on Wednesday nights, to our prayer team, and so that it will receive as much prayer as possible. So if you fill that out for more information or as a prayer request, I would encourage you to drop it in the offering plate. And I would encourage everybody, whether you fill it out or not, nobody wants to be that one person putting it in. And so if everybody puts it in, then nobody gets singled out. We have a lot of stuff stuffed in your bulletin this morning. Inside there, you're going to find this little card. This is a card talking about the next sermon series that we're doing. Many people have said, man, I wish I had an easy way to invite friends to church. Well, we're going to be starting a brand new sermon series next week, and this is all the information about it. So it's for your use, so that you know what's coming up, but also it's a little thing if you go to lunch this afternoon or whatnot, if you're meeting with friends, it's an easy way to invite friends to church. So I would encourage you to use that to do the legwork, to help you to do what you already want to do. I've already said alabaster offering. This evening, we're going to be having our Valentine's supper. If you have not already signed up, I think a few more won't hurt. Just talk to Penny and we'll make sure that we have plenty of food. And so find a sitter for the kids or whatever you need to do, and join us tonight at 6 p.m. for our Valentine's supper. And there's also a flyer in there for Love Without Fear Week from WORK. I encourage you to read through that and take it to heart as we seek to love without fear. My wife has an announcement to make before we take our morning tithes and offerings, so I will invite her up here.
I'm sure some of you can't believe it, but Matthew is going to be a year old in 8 days. So we wanted to invite you all to come celebrate with us next Saturday, the 16th, from 3 to 5 here at the church. We're having just an open house. No gifts are needed. We just want to celebrate and say thank you to those of you who have prayed with us over the last year for him to be the mischievous little boy that he is now. If you do feel like bringing something, we are accepting donations for the Ronald McDonald House in Bismarck, because they really did a lot for us when he was in the hospital. So come and join us. We'd love to have you.
Thank you. At this time, if our ushers will come forward, we'll receive the morning tithes and offerings.
I would see to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. One thing I ask and I would see, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. My heart and flesh cry out toward you, the living God. Your Spirit's water to my soul. I've tasted and I've seen. Come once again to me. I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you. Better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere, than thousands elsewhere.
Christ alone.
You're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Lord, I need you.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you that you are there when we need you. Lord, you are all that we need. And Lord, we praise you and we thank you for that. That when the weight of this world comes bearing down on us, Lord, we need to do nothing more than to look to you, for you are our sustainer, you are our rock. Lord, I pray for little Noelle this morning as she's dealing with this diagnosis and the changes in her life because of it. God, I pray that you would comfort her and her family during this time, that you would give them wisdom and help the doctors to teach her how to deal with this diagnosis. Lord, we pray that you would bring healing, that you would help her to live a normal, happy life in spite of this. Lord, we pray for Alan too and his family, that, Lord, as we don't know how much time is left, God, I pray that you would help the family to make the most of their time. 96 years is a wonderfully long life in human years, and so, Lord, I praise you for that. I pray that the family would rejoice in the time that they have and the time that they have left. Lord, I pray that you would continue to touch him and to work through his life and his family's lives to, Lord, to bring you glory and to bring you honor. Lord, I pray for Esther and for continued healing. Lord, I continue to pray for little Mary and the seizures that she's been having. And Lord, for the many other needs that are presented. Lord, you know each and every one. You know what's needed. And Lord, we trust in you. For like we said, Lord, you are all that we need. So the Lord, we leave them all in your hands, all the burdens, all the weight that we carry within this church, within our community. Lord, all the hurt that is going on. We trust in you. And we pray to you, Lord, knowing that you are the good Father, that you are the great physician, that nothing is beyond your power and nothing escapes your sight. So, Lord, we come to you and we pray. Lord, work in our hearts. Work in our community. Lord, restore that which is broken. Heal bodies. Heal families. Heal spirits, Lord, we pray. And we thank you, Lord, for the work you're already doing. And we pray that you would continue. Lord, may you use us to reach out into this hurting community. May you spur us on to love as you have loved. Lord, may your light shine brightly in this community. May this church be a beacon that people will know that is where healing is found. That is where love is found. We thank you, Lord. May your spirit fall upon us today. Embolden us, empower us to do your good and perfect will. We pray this, Lord, in your holy name. Amen.
What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone.
It's been a long journey over the last 6 weeks as we have started our year of love. This week marks the closing of our series, What the World Needs Now. Throughout the year, we're going to continue to speak on love, but next week we're going to shift our focus from love in the world to the transforming power of God's love in our lives. Over the progression of our current series, we've slowly been moving from the abstract to the practical, from the idea that God loves you to the practical application of that love in our lives and in the lives of others. Peter summarizes our journey so far well in 1 Peter chapter 4, where he says, above all, maintain constant love for one another, since love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaining. Just as each one has received a gift, use it to serve others as good stewards of the varied grace of God. If anyone speaks, let it be as one who speaks God's words. If anyone serves, let it be from the strength God provides, so that God may be glorified through Jesus Christ in everything. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. As he says, because you have been loved, because God has shared with you his blessings, his love, in turn, love others and share with them as well. He specifies, just as each one has received a gift. He doesn't say, if you have received a gift. God has gifted you in some way so that you can serve others. It's not a matter of if you can serve. It's a matter of how you can serve. As we said before, because you are loved, you can in turn love others. How you share that love with others is going to look different. How you do it is going to look different than how I do it. But God has given each of us unique tools, unique giftings, unique opportunities to share his love with others. What matters is not what you do, but how you do it and the motivation behind it. The list of ways that you can help and that you can serve is endless. But what's important is the heart behind it. Large corporations will give millions of dollars in donations to charities every year, but it's often to serve the purpose of a tax break rather than an action motivated by love. What's important is not what gift it is. It's that we use these gifts, but we must do so in God's strength and in God's love. That's what's going to make a real difference, is not the actions, but the heart behind them. Love is what matters. Remember from 1 Corinthians chapter 13 that while everything else will fade away, love will remain. While the music will someday stop, the preaching will someday cease, the service to others will come to an end, but love will remain. This earth will cease, but love will go on forever. It's the one thing that will last forever. And so we should hold on to it all the more as we journey this earth. And all of this love, all of this service, all of this sacrifice begins right here, right now, in our everyday lives. We have the opportunity each and every day to learn and to practice. And the church is where we learn to love like Jesus. The church is where we are prepared for love and good works. So that you don't misunderstand me, I'm not talking about the walls of this building. I'm not saying that you must enter through those doors in order to learn how to love. When I'm speaking of the church, I'm not talking about the building or the structure or any legally owned property by an organization. The church is much more than a building. The concept of the church being a structure built by man, it would have been a foreign concept to early church leaders. These men and women would meet in public places or in people's homes. To them, it was clear what the church was. The church was the people. The church was the community. Since that time, we've begun slapping the name of church on buildings all across the world. We've shifted from a community mentality to a consumer mentality. Many people no longer consider themselves to be a part of a church. Rather, they attend church. And while there is a growing popularity in this view, that view is not the biblical view of the church. Since its inception, the church has always been more than an address on a map. The word church comes from the Greek word ekklesia, which literally means called out ones. It was often used of those who, during a time of emergency, would come out from their daily lives to serve, much like volunteer firefighters today. When a need arose, average citizens would be called out from their daily lives to serve their community. And likewise, we as the church are called to serve as well, but it's the name has extra meaning for us. Yes, we are called out to serve our community, but we have also been called out from our lives of sin. We have been called out from the taint of mankind, called to serve a higher purpose. We have been called to eternal life. We are one people, united together under the banner and under the mission of Jesus Christ. And this spans beyond this local congregation. Within Beulah, Hazen, and the surrounding area, there are many different congregations, but there is one church. Those that affirm and trust in Jesus Christ, God's only begotten Son, the second person of the triune Godhead, those who trust in Him and accept that His sacrifice for all mankind, they are just as much a part of this church as we are. It is one body with many parts joined together under the banner of our Lord and Savior. The church is the people. The church is you. The church is me. The church is them. But unfortunately, in our modern society, it has become quite popular to criticize and to trash the church. Books hit the bestseller list that are criticizing the church, that do nothing more than tear the church down. Famous pastors and church leaders sell out auditoriums as they speak out against the church. We've grown cynical. We get down on the church. But the truth is, we are the church. Certainly, we're not perfect by any means. We have our faults. It's a shame that many people within the church are so down on the church. It's a shame because despite all of our flaws, despite all of our failures, Christ loves us. Christ loves the church. Routinely, Scripture will talk of the church as the bride of Christ. Not the organization, not the building, but the people. And that's what the church is. When these books and these speakers talk out against the church, when they trash the church, they're not talking about some faceless organization. They're talking about you and me. They're talking about our parents and our grandparents, those saints who came before, who sacrificed daily so that the gospel of Jesus Christ could be heard. Yes, there are congregations. Yes, there are pastors who have done pretty terrible things. The church is made up of fallen, selfish, broken people. It certainly has its problems. But we are still the bride of Christ. We are still the one that Jesus loves. This gathering, with all of its imperfections, is the place where Christ has said we are to learn to love like He does. Ephesians chapter 5 goes into explanation of this. It contains a passage of Scripture that we often use when discussing the relationship between a husband and a wife. This is the passage where Paul says, "Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord, because the husband is the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church." He continues by saying, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself to her to make her holy, cleansing her with the washing of water by the word." And there is great wisdom in this passage for marriage relationships. But this passage speaks to a greater audience than just husbands and wives. This passage speaks to the church as a whole. In these verses, Paul is speaking to the church, and it is revealed a few verses later when he says, "For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This mystery is profound, but I am talking about Christ in the church." Paul purposely is choosing this image of a husband and a wife, that passionate, intimate relationship, to bridge that gap and to tell people, what I'm talking about is Christ in the church. What I'm talking about is the relationship between Christ and the church. There is a passionate connection between Jesus and the church, just like there is between a husband and a wife. The passion and the love that drove him to willingly take the cross. And we, the church, are united with Christ through this love and this sacrifice. We aren't just bystanders who sit back and watch Jesus do his thing. We aren't bystanders that sit on the sidelines and applaud other people as they do his mission. We are to be the picture of Christ in this world. And if we're going to learn to love like Christ, and if we're going to teach others to do the same, the place to learn how to love everybody always is in the local church. Because it's in the local church that we learn about the love that Jesus has for us. Even though we may mess it up sometimes, even though we don't always say it with the best words, among the body of Christ is where people learn that Jesus loves them. I mean, who told you that Jesus loved you? A member of the church. A person of the church gave you that Bible that you read and you understood Christ's love for you. We learn of his sacrifice and the limitless love of God in and through the church. We learn what it means to have compassion and forgiveness, just as Christ has had for us. In the church is where we practice loving each other, even when it's hard. We've been given many tools to help us to love others, but it takes practice. We can learn about love all day long, but if we're really going to make a difference, then we need to practice it. We need to practice forgiveness. We need to practice empathy. We need to practice hospitality. And God has given us each other to practice on. God has given you lots of guinea pigs to practice love and forgiveness. Practice on one another so that we can get it right. And so that as we journey out into the world to share his love, we will have it down. It will be second nature to us because we have first practiced here within the church. Because as the church, we go into all the world loving everybody together. We are united in Christ, in his love and in his mission. That means that this group gathered here and each congregation scattered around the area, that we should all be banding together, linking arm in arm to demonstrate love in our community and in our country. It isn't a lone wolf type of thing where we do our thing and they do their thing. We may reach different audiences, but we are journeying together to love this world. We are many parts working together to ensure that everybody knows and experiences the love of Jesus Christ. Because as Christians, We are the church. Therefore, we need to be passionate about the church. We need to love the church. We can't just casually date the church. This body, the bride of Christ, deserves passionate love. And we do this love thing way better as a family than we do as individuals. It's time that we get passionate about the church, the body of Christ. Are you passionate about the church? If you are, then prove it. We prove our passion when we gather together. Hebrews 10:25 tells us, "And let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near." Coming together as a church on a regular basis helps us to remain unified. It keeps us on the same page as we walk this journey together, as we work at this mission together. It gives us the opportunity to practice love and to organize our efforts so that we can reach out into our community and into our world. But when we don't gather together, it all falls apart. We go our separate ways. We are no longer unified. We prove our passion when we grow together. And let us watch out for one another to provoke love and good works. We're all going to grow at different rates. We're all going to grow differently, but we must be growing. You show your passion for Christ's church when you concern yourself for the members of that body. When you concern yourself with the spiritual growth of the people sitting next to you, those that are gathered together. When you look beyond yourself and what you can get out of it, and you look to the spiritual growth of someone else. Yes, it's good if you are growing. I hope that you are growing. But we are supposed to push each other, prod each other, encourage each other to grow, to love deeper. A body cannot remain healthy unless it is all growing together. We prove our passion for the church when we give together. 2 Corinthians 9:13 says, "As a result of your ministry, they will give glory to God, for your generosity to them and all believers will prove that you are obedient to the good news of Christ." And I'm not just talking finances here. I'm not just talking about money. This giving goes beyond your pocketbook. It goes to your time, your energy, your skills. Granted, some people have more money or time to give. But when we give together as a community in Christ, we have a vested interest. We have a vested interest in the church, in the body, and we prove that it's not a competition of who can give more, but it's a loving expression, a natural expression, giving back, giving into that mission, giving into that body of Christ. And finally, we prove our passion for the church when we go together. Paul appealed to the church in Corinth, saying, "Now I urge you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree in what you say, that there be no divisions among you, and that you be united with the same understanding and the same conviction." He's speaking to a church here who was divided. Some said, "I follow Paul's teaching." Some said, "I follow Apollo's teaching." And they were divided. And he's telling them, "You guys are one church together, walking hand in hand in unity. You may disagree on things, and that's okay. Certain topics may cause an emotional response. We disagree with other churches in this area, but we are unified in Christ Jesus. In the end, we are united in Christ in our mission to bring the gospel to all corners of the earth. We prove our passion for the church when we focus not on what is different, not on what divides us, but on what unifies us, on what brings us together. We may quietly discuss our differences, talk about it in peace with one another, but all the while we are united, walking hand in hand towards the mission of Jesus Christ in love. Because we are the church, the bride of Christ, and we are to love everybody always. And that's what it means to be the church. That's who we are as the church. It's not a large, faceless organization, but it's you and me. It's our brothers and sisters down the street gathering in the name of Jesus Christ, God's only begotten Son. We are the church, and if we are going to fulfill the mission of the church, then we must love the church. This is what it looks like to passionately love the church, to lift up one another, to spur one another on, to gather together in unity and to help each other to grow deeper in love with Jesus. What the world needs right now is a whole lot of love. What the world, what the country, what our community needs is love. And who better to show them love than the one who is himself love and those who are united with him? We are the church, the bride of Christ. What the world needs now is love. What the church needs is the church. Or what the world needs is the church. And we as the church, we have a whole lot of love to give. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, Lord, may we grow passionately in love with your bride. May we grow passionately in love with the people that make up the church, embracing one another, spurring each other on, seeking the best for each other. Lord, may we actively practice love within our church settings, that we may go into the world and be all the more better at it. For Lord, you have called us to love as you have loved. Lord, may we fall in love with your bride. And Lord, may we band together to love this world that you gave yourself for. Lord, go before us. Open our eyes to ways in which we are not acting like we love the church. Lord, open our minds to see areas where we are falling short. And Lord, may we grow more and more passionately in love with your bride each and every day. Go before us, Lord, and prepare our ways, we pray. In your holy and precious name, amen.